Ladies and gentlemen, welcome back to my channel, and if you're new here, welcome to my channel. Feel free to browse around on some of my playlists, and while you're at it, consider subscribing since my 25,000 subscriber giveaway is just around the corner, where you will have the opportunity to win a huge prize. Today though, I have a really fun video for you guys. At first, I didn't know what to title this video. Basically, what the aim of this video is to compare and contrast the most affordable MacBook Pro you can currently get with one of the most expensive. My 16-inch technically isn't the most expensive because my SSD isn't maxed out to 8 TB, but all the specs are the highest you can currently get in a MacBook Pro. So how pro is the 13-inch base Pro? We're about to find out and put them head-to-head in a series of grueling tests. So without wasting any more time, let's just jump straight into them. So it's pretty obvious that this head-to-head showdown isn't meant for someone to make a tough decision. Like, this is from one end of the spending spectrum to the other, but it's still informative and showcases the raw power of the 16-inch beast. You can find the base 13-inch MacBook Pro from Apple for $1,299. This is a lot of money, I get it. But you'll see from these tests that the entry 13-inch Pro isn't exactly all that pro. While this specific 16-inch MacBook Pro comes in at a whopping $4,299. I'll throw all the specs of each machine up on the screen right now, but here's the thing. It isn't all about performance. I, for one, absolutely am in love with the design of the 13-inch. It's small, compact, light, all but the chunkier bezels, the design of the 13-inch is one of the most impressive I've ever seen on any notebook. If Apple truly is starting to listen to their audience again, they'll release a 14-inch MacBook Pro. So Apple, if you're listening, you already know the vibes. Give us the MacBook Pro 16-inch treatment and reduce the bezels on the 13-inch MacBook Pro. I'd stop whatever I am doing, and I mean whatever, just to order one. I'm putting that on everything. So anyway, let's go ahead and get started. First off, you already know what it is. It is customary amongst us spec geeks to always start with Geekbench. The test name itself is roasting us, cause we're geeks. Gang. Now keep in mind the 13-inch has a quad-core processor while the 16-inch has an 8-core processor. So it is pretty safe to assume big differences in multi-core performance. So for single-core, we get a score of 937 for the 13-inch and a score of 1154 for the 16-inch. Honestly, not too far apart, but again, the 13-inch model is pretty capable at handling applications that don't utilize several cores at one time. We see a much more drastic difference on multi-core though, as the 13-inch comes in with a score of 3,941, while the 16-inch behemoth nearly doubles that, with a score of 7,220. I like using Geekbench because it comprises a lot of different aspects of a machine's capabilities with raw benchmarks. We conducted the OpenCL test using Geekbench as well and saw results of 7,190 versus a whopping 28,541, nearly 4 times better than the 13-inch. And lastly, on our metal test, which primarily focuses on the GPU and the graphical potential of a machine, we see a score of 3,173 and wait for it, 28,328 on the MacBook Pro 16-inch. This isn't a surprise though, as the 13-inch only has integrated graphics, being the Intel Iris Plus Graphics 645, while the 16-inch has a dedicated AMD Radeon Pro 5500M with 8 GB of GDDR6 memory. All of this graphical disparity will be showcased heavily in some of these future tests. Okay, moving on to yet another very popular benchmarking test. We're gonna look at the Heaven Graphics Benchmark Test. I've used the Heaven benchmark countless times as it gives a pretty good indication as to whether your computer can handle modern gaming or whether a potato has a better chance at playing games smoothly. Here, unfortunately, the 13-inch MacBook Pro falls in the latter camp, having an abysmal Heaven score of 703, while the 16-inch didn't do all that bad, honestly, with a score of 1,852. It gets progressively worse for the poor little 13-inch, having averaged out a measly 27.9 frames per second, hardly being able to handle any form of intense gaming. You'll see a ton of dropped frames while playing any sort of graphically intensive game, and you best believe your 13-inch will get hotter than Arkansas on a sunny 4th of July day. The 16-inch, on the other hand, 73.5. Not bad. Not the best, but pretty respectable. Cinebench. The test that notoriously makes just about any laptop's fans kick into overdrive. Seriously, the fans on the 13 inch spun so loud, it was like listening to a vacuum cleaner from a few meters away. Cinebench R20 taps into the internals to max them out and push them to their limits. In this test, the 13 inch took noticeably longer to complete and finished with a score of 1629, while the 16 inch more than doubled that at 3461. Just goes to show how much more powerful the 16 inch is over the 13 inch. We now go over some deeper tests to really gauge how well these two computers handle heavy workloads. For the first one, we will do the blender test, and no, I'm not talking about putting these in a huge blender and seeing if they'll survive. I'm talking about the blender benchmark test. This test is superb at analyzing just about every aspect of a machine's capabilities and takes quite a bit of time to complete. The blender benchmark is great for those interested in how well the computer processes 3D software as well as analyze performance for CUDA, OpenCL, CPU, and GPU performance. As expected, our 16-inch comes out on top, finishing the test in a respectable 19 minutes and 30 seconds, while the 13-inch, well, let's just say I was able to play about 8 games of Clash Royale on the toilet after the 16-inch finished, and it still wasn't done. It finally prevailed though, clocking in at 45 minutes and 18 seconds. Next up, I wanted to use a test I recently discovered, and that is mainly testing for RAM and CPU performance. This test, called NovaBench, runs a fairly quick benchmark and assesses the CPU, GPU, and even RAM, and designates a score for them. I don't know of many other tests that looks into RAM performance, so let's look into that right now. Keep in mind, this base 13-inch only comes with 8GB of DDR3 memory clocked at 2133MHz, while this specific 16-inch comes configured with 64GB of DDR4 memory clocked at a much higher 2666MHz. So, it is safe to assume running multiple apps, including pro applications, and especially running 3 Google Chrome tabs will run much more smoothly on the 16-inch. The 13-inch comes in with a RAM score of 215, while the 16-inch RAM score is 350. Again, not only is there more RAM, but also higher clocked RAM. And for CPU, the 13-inch achieved the score of 839 and 1381 for the 16-inch on this specific test. We now take a break from CPU, GPU, and all of that noise, and move on to what arguably is one of the most important things when buying a computer, and that is storage. So this one is important as you want a decently sized SSD to store all your media, but what a lot of people never look at or even think about is read and write speeds. In essence, the read speed is how long your computer takes to open a file. Think about opening a book and reading it. While the write speed means what you'd expect, it's the exact opposite. It measures how long it takes to save something onto a storage device, so think writing down notes to save for later. I was caught completely sideways by this test. I did the good old Blackmagic test. Interestingly, the read speed on the 13-inch was averaging about 1.2 gigs give or take a second, while the 16-inch was at about 2.5 gigs a second. The write speeds, on the other hand, saw abysmal performance on the 13-inch, averaging about 300 megabytes a second, while the 16-inch pretty consistently hovered around 2.5 gigs a second. I thought, surely this can't be right. So I pulled up my backup test, the lesser-known AJA test, and tried it using this test. Once again, we see similar results, with the 13-inch having read speeds of 1.1 gigs a second and 2.8 gigs for the 16-inch, and write speeds of 500 megs a second versus 2.8 gigs a second for the 16-inch. That's pretty crazy, man. It just shows how much slower the read and write speeds are on the 128GB SSD found on the 13-inch. But benchmarks are one thing though, so I decided to test it using something one would commonly do. At first, I transferred a 4GB photography file from my SD card to the 13-inch's SSD. That file transferred in 1 minute and 1 second on the 13-inch and 50 seconds for the 16-inch. Then, what I did is deleted the folder on the SD card and then transferred the same file from the MacBooks back onto the SD card. This was much slower, as expected from the benchmarks, and transferred the 4GB file in 3 minutes and 30 seconds for the 13-inch and 2 minutes and 57 seconds on the 16-inch. The thing is, this was only a 4GB file. Typically, I transfer folders much larger, and of course the speeds on the SD card itself do factor in, but you can see just how big the differences in times will start to add up when working with 40GB files, or even huge files like 100GB. We're almost done. we're finding some interesting results, but it gets even more wild when discussing the topic of video editing. After these results, you can make your own conclusions. The Bruce X test is a 2-second 5K clip, but has a lot of things going on the editing and exporting end. Using the same exact compressor settings, the 16-inch finished exporting it in just 15 seconds. And guess how long it took the 13-inch? 30 seconds? 60? 90? Nope, 2 minutes and 41 seconds. Jesus Christ. Okay, but this is just a 2-second clip. What about something longer? Shooting in 4K on my Sony a7 III, I filmed a random 6-minute video and again, used the same compressor settings, same video, same everything. And on the 16-inch, it exported it in 5 minutes and 8 seconds, while the 13-inch gave me enough time to make me some instant ramen and then finished up in 18 minutes and 46 seconds, way, way slower than I had expected. So it goes to show, the 13-inch Pro can handle light editing, but anything heavy would just be a disservice to you and your time. Especially with a lot of content creators where time is money, you really want to avoid the 13-inch base model if you're looking into video editing as a hobby or if you're making any kind of income from it. And finally, for the final test, for all my photographers, I exported 250 JPEGs of varying sizes out of Lightroom to see if there were any huge differences. The more I tested and compared the two, the more I was surprised by just how slower the 13-inch Pro is versus the newer 16-inch counterpart. The 16-inch exported all 250 JPEGs in 1 minute and 51 seconds, while the 13-inch did it in 5 minutes flat. These are all some pretty crazy results. But overall, what have we learned today? Well, we can see that the 13 Pro isn't really all that pro. Sure, I get it. It is the entry-level model versus the highest spec MacBook Pro one can possibly buy in early 2020. But still, makes me wonder how many people buy the 13-inch Pro expecting it to run pro-level applications and expecting it to be the best of the best because of the Pro moniker. Trust me, I realize the 13-inch model has a severely underclocked 1.4 GHz quad-core processor. For my needs and a lot of content creators, the base 13-inch just ain't it, chief. What Apple needs to do is release a much more affordable MacBook because undoubtedly, hundreds if not thousands of people pick up the base 13-inch MacBook Pro having no clue about how specs work and how they correlate with performance and will use it as a Facebook and YouTube browsing machine, essentially burning their money. Most definitely, the 2.4 GHz 13-inch MacBook Pro with two additional USB-C ports is a much smarter purchase, but I guess Apple is really prying and trying to hit that uninformed market of consumers trying to buy the most budget-friendly MacBook Pro they can find. Sure, there's the Air, but it's not much cheaper than the base 13-inch Pro, to be quite honest. What Apple needs is like an $800 MacBook with similar specs to the Air and base Pro with stripped down features or lower end hardware to bring that price down, but that is another video for another day. Well guys, these testing videos are extremely fun to make, but are very time consuming and very tedious to put together. So if you found this video useful, a like would be greatly appreciated and don't forget to subscribe for content just like this along with in-depth reviews, unboxings, and giveaways with huge prizes. That's been it for me, guys. As always, take care of yourselves and each other. Peace.